Welcome back to Future Perfect. The arrival of Apple's first iPad was widely hailed as the beginning of the post-PC era. But if you think the 700-pound gorilla of the age of personal computers is about to quietly fade away into the sunset, think again. Microsoft's next operating system, dubbed Windows 8, is about to crash the post-PC party. While Steve Jobs intends to keep tablets and PCs as separate universes, Steve Ballmer intends to fuse these two devices into one seamless user experience. But will Microsoft succeed, or is Windows 8 just another Vista waiting to happen? And to help us answer this question, we're joined here in the studio by renowned tech blogger Abe Olandres of yugatech.com. Abe, thank you for coming to the show.
Thanks for having
me. Thank you, seatmate on the bus in China. All right. You know, Windows 8 obviously has been touted as the next touchscreen operating system because it's also designed to work well with touchscreen devices.
Actually, the biggest problem with Microsoft before was when the tablets came out and became very popular. Their operating system, which is Windows 7 at that time, wasn't really optimized for tablets. So their biggest goal for now, for the next operating system, which is Windows 8, would be to fuse and make the operating system very usable on the desktop, that's laptops or, you know, desktop PCs, as well as tablets.
And on mobile Windows devices as well.
Yes.
Because
and
Windows 7 already had a touchscreen interface to it.
The problem with the UI that's being used for Windows 7 in the previous operating system from Microsoft is that it's really a keyboard plus mouse combination.
Right.
And the use of capacitive touch screens and a touch interface wasn't really thought of very well.
Right.
So when they launched Windows Phone 7, they introduced the Metro UI. And it's the same UI that's now being used for Windows 8.
So it's just like the Apple philosophy now of having the iOS ported over to MacBooks and the iMac, right?
Yes, exactly. It looks like they're following the same footsteps as Apple did with iOS and the Mac OS X.
Okay, we're showing, of course, what Windows 8 looks like because we connected your laptop to our bigger monitor here. So we'll be showing what the Windows 8 environment looks like. So Abe, guide us through it.
So this is the lock screen on the Windows 8. It shows you, you know, the date, some notifications. Actually, there's also a built-in SMS application or feature. So I think they're going to support tablets with 3G SIM cards.
Right. Okay. So let's go into the home screen.
So if you're using a mouse or if you're using your fingers, just swipe up.
Swipe up.
Either you don't have a password here, but I placed mine.
Okay, and we have to explain to our audience that right now you've installed Windows 8 on a
Regular laptop.
A regular laptop, a netbook, but you don't have a tablet yet that's running on Windows 8.
Actually, I have a tablet here. It's a local tablet from Cube, which I also installed Windows 8, actually.
Windows 8?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'd be interested maybe to show as well what the touchscreen experience would be like on Windows 8. But before we go to that, all right, just show us what's on the netbook.
So the first thing that will greet you after you log in from the lock screen would be the start menu. These are the tiles. This is called the Metro UI.
The Metro UI.
Yes.
For the metrosexual guy in you.
It's composed of tiles. So applications, settings, shortcuts, and controls are shown, represented via tiles.
Okay.
Which you can actually
you can rearrange. You can rearrange, okay.
So they're very intuitive and really easy to use. And you just scroll to the right, and they're grouped according to functions or
So in a sense, they're
features.
Like widgets on the screen. They're widgets, right? Okay, what kind of native widgets are there that come with Windows 8?
Actually, Microsoft has sent out a developer preview so that, you know, Microsoft developers can create widgets and applications. So the default ones that we're seeing here would be some weather widget. There's a built-in Twitter, Twitter application.
It's on Twitter app.
Yeah. And for a regular PC user, this might look like a little odd or alien to them, but there's also the desktop menu. So you can go back.
All right, let's show the screen. The desktop menu. Okay. So you can
actually show the regular Windows 7.
Go back to the classic Windows 7.
Exactly.
Layout. Okay.
And then just click again on that Microsoft flag, and you're back
and you're
to
back to the Metro UI desktop. Mm-hmm. Okay, now let's show how it performs on a touchscreen tablet now. So you hold it, Abe, and we'll shoot from behind you. Uh-huh. Okay, guide us through how it performs when you swipe through the pages.
So again, from the lock screen, just swipe it down up. Or up. Mm-hmm. And then it will show you the start screen with all of the widgets and the tiles. Mm-hmm. To go to a menu, just swipe from the right.
Okay, swipe from the right. So it has to be, you have to take to get used
from the
to,
edge, yeah.
You have to get used to some of the touch gestures.
Some of the gestures here. Right. So swiping from the right will show you some settings, the start screen, mm-hmm. a search function, and the share.
So that's the sidebar.
Yes, the sidebar. Right. If you swipe from the left side, it will actually...
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you got to close, I guess, that one. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then swipe from the left.
Mm-hmm. A swipe from the left would show you all of the applications.
Ah, okay, so that reveals all of the installed apps mm-hmm. on your device.
And it rotates in a carousel way.
All right, let's try that.
It's not really.
Did you try that at home, Abe?
Yes, I tried it a while ago.
It was working.
It is working.
Okay. I'm not sure that the studio has any interference on your device. Now, you said this is a developer. Is this a developer?
Yes, this is a developer preview. So it's actually before a beta.
Yeah, even before a beta release.
Yeah, beta release. So they're looking at a beta release and then a release candidate. After that, the ready to manufacturer, release to manufacturer. Mm. And then, so I'm thinking like, give it a year or a year and a half for Microsoft to actually release this to the public.
So you don't think it's going to, you know, accelerate the final version of Windows 8 because, I mean, it's got to play catch up with Apple, with iOS, and even with Android. I mean, Google releasing some of the flavors of its Android operating systems, you know, consistently predictable. You know, that they actually come out with updates, and Microsoft is lagging behind.
The problem with Microsoft is that they have to contend with the millions and millions of existing users that runs on Windows 7, Windows XP.
Different flavors of Windows.
Different flavors and hardware configurations. Mm. Unlike iOS with Apple, it's just one hardware device with very little differences in configuration. Mm. It's either the 3G or the Wi-Fi. Mm. With Windows 8, you're looking at desktop PCs, laptops, netbooks, tablets. There's so many configurations that device drivers.
So there's something to be said for a closed ecosystem.
Exactly. So that's the point there. It's easier to roll out, you know, and to develop a mobile or a tablet operating system when you have control of the hardware.
Now, we did say in the lead in to our interview that this could just very well wind up to be the next Vista. Do you see that risk happening now?
I look at the Windows 8, and if you strip down the Metro UI, it goes back to Windows 7. Mm-kay. So I don't think Microsoft could go wrong with Windows 7. The UI and the skins would probably be most suitable for tablets, but I think people would still look for the familiar, you know, Internet Explorer, Windows Explorer.
Now you had some problem with the swiping from the left.
From
all right, so just swipe up. Is that right?
Swipe from the right.
Swipe from the right.
Mm-hmm. To show the menu. That's the menu.
That's the menu. Uh-huh. Now, just to swipe from the left. I don't need to hide the menu from the right.
Okay. The swipe from the left will rotate all the open applications. So, if actually earlier we don't have any open applications.
So we don't have any open applications.
So you can just open like Internet Explorer.
All right. Let's try opening Internet
Explorer.
And
then Windows Explorer there.
I'm tapping on it.
Let's try the Windows Explorer. The biggest problem with this hardware actually is that the resolution is netbook spec.
Yeah.
So it's like 1024 by 600 pixels. Okay. And I think the minimum requirements for Windows 8 is that you need to have 1024 by 768 pixels. So if your resolution is lower, it won't launch the applications.
Okay. Well, I guess it's not launching anything. All right. But you tried it on that device. Mm-hmm. Is there any other device now that you could install it on?
Actually, if you have other Intel-based tablets. So there are a couple of other locally available tablets that runs on Windows 7, Windows XP. So you can actually just upgrade. The minimum requirements would be you need to have a 1 gigahertz processor.
Okay.
And then a
That's pretty common for most.
Yeah, very, very common. I think netbook starts at 1.6. And you need to have at least 1 gigabyte of RAM and 16 gigabytes of hard drive space.
Okay. And does it look like the Metro UI, the interface that they've designed, you know, as you said, you know, it might be a little bit confusing maybe to some of the users of earlier versions of Windows. Can you see any improvements that need to be done with the Metro UI?
Actually, it's still in the very early stage.
Yeah.
So,
what do you want to see how it evolves? I mean, how it should look like?
I guess I'm very, very familiar with the Metro UI because I've been using a Windows Phone 7. Mm-hmm. So I guess the resolution should have been, you know, thought of very well, because a lot of netbooks nowadays are only running at 600 pixels. So I'm thinking that when the final release is, you know, shipped out, a lot of people would be frustrated installing a non-functional OS under netbooks.
Okay, well, will it pose a challenge to Android tablet devices and, of course, to iOS mobile devices?
From a developer perspective and from a power user perspective, it might. The idea with Windows 8 on a tablet is that you don't need to just use it for content consumption, like, you know, browsing a website,
watching
streaming
movies.
Videos, watching movies. Is that when you dock this, attach it to a keyboard or a mouse, you get a full-fledged computer. You can run like Adobe Photoshop or do some really high-end and multitasking.
So the power is there,
yes,
but the resources that it needs to run it doesn't necessarily have to be as powerful as a full-fledged desktop.
Exactly. So you're looking at, say, just watching a movie or, you know, doing some browsing, and just detach the tablet part and then use it as you would on a regular tablet. But if you want to do some really powerful number crunching or some videos or some editing or programming, you can just attach it to keyboard or a Bluetooth keyboard.
So you think the final configuration would be, or the final devices would be, mostly a lot of these screens that have dockable keyboards?
Yes, exactly. Actually, when they showed it at the Build conference a couple of weeks ago, some of the tablets, the prototype tablets from Samsung, were actually paired with a dockable keyboard.
Yeah. So the devices of the future would look like this standard configuration. You have a touchscreen that can dock onto a keyboard, and you'll bring it with you like an ordinary netbook.
Yes. So I think the logic behind it is that when you go home, you still go to your desktop PC, you still go to your laptop, and when you go on a trip or you know, go to work, you bring your tablet with
you. Portable.
So the idea is that why not have a single device to do both?
Okay.
So when you go home, dock it in, and when you go to the office
or go to the mall, just
bring
make
the
sure
tablet part.
Just make sure that you go to the mall and not have any guns with you. All right, Abe, pleasure to see you again after being with you for our 4-day road trip to China.
It was a fun trip.
Fun trip. All right, and thanks very much for explaining how Windows 8 looks like now and how it might look like a year from now. Thanks very much for coming to the show.
Pleasure to be here.
And coming up, Future Perfect packs up its bags and travels to the land where almost all of our gadgets and gizmos are made. We're not talking about Europe. Stay tuned as we polish our Mandarin and dive into the guts of a Chinese electronics factory.